So in any cryptography class, the first primitive which we always study is encryption, and that is also what we will start with here today. So as I mentioned, this class not only it focuses on explaining you the big ideas and so on, but also how to formalize these ideas and how to analyze the schemes and so on. So before we start discussing encryption, let's first start discussing what encryption is, okay? So let me start by writing symmetric key encryption. Syntax. So we will talk about security and so on later on, but let's first talk about what a symmetric key encryption system should look like. And I'm sure that you know that there's also something called as public key encryption, which we'll get into later on. Classically, people have just looked at symmetric key encryption and what it does and so on. Okay, so we will denote it by SKE. Sometimes people also call it secret key encryption. You can also call it a cipher and so on. Okay. So any symmetric key encryption scheme consists of three algorithms. So when you specify, let's say you design your own symmetric key encryption scheme, you must specify three different algorithms. So must consist of three algorithms. And I hope that you can read what I'm writing. Just give me a second. Okay, so what are the three algorithms? The first algorithm is called gen or key gen. And this is not K, this is kappa. So as the name suggests, this algorithm in some sense generates a random key and then just outputs it, okay? And in different algorithms, this procedure might be different. And when we discuss the actual algorithms, we will see how it works, but this takes as input what is known as a security parameter. And outputs a secret key. Let's call this key K. And note that the input is kappa, the output is a secret key K. So what is a security parameter? And this is something which you will see all the time in cryptography. So when we talk about encryption schemes or really any kind of algorithm in cryptography, you always have a security parameter in mind, right? So in some sense, the security parameter will determine the length of the key. If you choose like a 100-bit key, it might give you some sort of security, like the adversary can break your system, can guess your key with probability 2^-100, right? Maybe you are not happy with 2^-100, maybe you want 2^-1,000. So in that case, you would set your kappa to be bigger, and the key generation algorithm will output a much longer key in that case, right? So you can also think of kappa as the size of the key. So the security parameter determines the size of the key. The second algorithm is called the encryption algorithm. So encryption algorithm takes two inputs. The first is the secret key K, which is the key generation algorithm output. And then second is the message which you want to encrypt. And then this algorithm outputs a ciphertext. C. Right? And then finally, we have the decryption algorithm, which again takes the secret key as input. It takes the ciphertext and it outputs a message M. Okay, so this is what the basic syntax looks like. I have not talked about the security or any of the properties which this should satisfy. But let me make two remarks. So remark one is that scheme might specify a particular message space. So as an example, the message must be an element of some message space, this curly M, and this message space could, for example, just be two messages, let's say attack or defend, let's say you are in a war, right? And you only have two possible commands to give to your soldiers, either attack or defend, right? Or this message could be any 100-bit message. So as an example, this message space could be equal to 01 to the power 50, let's say, right? So in that case, this scheme allows you to encrypt any 50-bit messages, okay? Now, if you choose a message which is not part of this message space, all bets are off. The encryption scheme may not work correctly. Maybe it works correctly, but the security no longer holds and so on. Right, so in that case, I mean, it's like using a room heater to boil water. Not anything can go wrong in that case. And then we have another remark, let's call it the correctness requirement. So correctness just says the following. You generated the secret key as intended using the key generation algorithm. Then you encrypted some message M using the encryption algorithm. Now, when you decrypt the resulting ciphertext using that key, you should always get back the same message. Okay? And we can write it in terms of probability. Correctness says that probability of decryption, the probability that you decrypt a ciphertext C and it results in M such that the key came from the key generation algorithm using kappa and ciphertext came from the encryption algorithm using K and M, this probability must be equal to 1. Right? You should always get back the same message. What about security? Let me not talk about that yet. Okay? So this is so far our definition, and we will come back to this later on. Now let me look at some of the classical ciphers. Probably the oldest recorded cipher in history is what is known as Caesar's cipher. I hope I'm spelling it correctly. So Caesar's cipher were used like more than 2000 years ago in Roman Empire, where Julius Caesar used the cipher to send like messages to his commanders, his war generals. It's a very simple cipher, probably worked very well at that time, but you know, I will show you the cipher and you will immediately tell me how to break it. It's very simple. So let me specify the Caesar cipher, and the first algorithm which we need to specify is keygen. So in Caesar cipher, there is no security parameter. You can give it a security parameter, but it will ignore it because the key is always sort of fixed length. So key is just an integer from 0 to 25. And where does this come from? In English language, we have 26 different characters from A to Z, right? So the 0 to 25 just represents picking one of these characters. So A represents 0 getting picked, and 25 corresponds to Z. How do I encrypt a message? So let me specify the message space. For Caesar cipher, the message space is just a sequence of English letters. And for simplicity, let's assume there's no comma, there's no space. Of course, you can generalize the cipher to those cases as well. Shift each character in M by K. And I'll take an example. The last algorithm is the decryption algorithm, which takes the resulting ciphertext and the key, and you shift back each character in ciphertext again by the same amount K. Okay? So as an example, let's say your key is 1, just to make my life simple. Let's say your message is attack. What is the ciphertext in this case? So A shifted by 1 becomes B. T shifted by 1, STU, it becomes U, so BUU. Then again B, and then D, K becomes L. Okay? So let's say you are naive, you don't really know much about encryption and things like that. the ciphertext might look like complete junk to you. It may not necessarily reveal what the message is and so on. Right? So it's probably a very smart idea at that time, but any ideas on how we can break the Caesar cipher? Is this secure? And we have not defined security yet, but you know, intuitively we all understand what encryption scheme is supposed to do. Okay, so let's see, there are some. Okay, so quite a few interesting ideas. Just try all 26 possibilities. Yeah, that's probably the simplest answer in this case. Try all possible keys. And here, the key space is just so limited, right? I don't even need a computer for this. I can just try every possible key. I can just do a reverse shift, try to decrypt with every possible key, and then I can look which message makes sense. Presumably, I can identify the correct message when I see it, because it will be some message in English sentence, hopefully something I can understand, right? So this is very easy to break. So it is not secure at all. So let's move on to our second toy example. And by the way, let me remark that this is called as ciphertext only attack. This attack only requires you to have just one ciphertext. And then you can sort of launch an exhaustive attack and you will be successful. Ciphertext only attack is the worst kind of attack because it means that your scheme has no security whatsoever. There's also a plain text ciphertext attack where you can attack the scheme only if you get a pair of message and ciphertext, and then all further messages you can decrypt. Why are we defining with the assumption that we know what the algorithm is? That's a very good question. And I should probably write it here. So you can think of it as sort of a religious rule in modern cryptography. You can never rely on your algorithms being secret, right? So there are two reasons for it. First reason is, what is the probability that adversary can guess your algorithm? Honestly, I don't know what this probability is. You know, if you ask me, if you give me like a 100-bit number, right? Or if you pick a 100-bit number and if you ask me to guess it, you can tell me that the probability that I'll be successful is like 2^-100. But what is the probability that an adversary can guess your algorithm? I don't know. It's just mathematics doesn't tell me that. So this is hard to say. Right? So in the worst case, let's just assume that adversary can guess my algorithm with high probability. The second reason for this is that there are all kind of things, like let's say there's an insider attack. Okay. There could be a computer hack. And so on. So typically when you design a cryptographic algorithm, there might be a large team of people who are involved, like a large team of mathematicians, they collaborate together, they come up with an encryption algorithm. So if the enemy, for example, let's say gets hold of any of them or they collude with the enemy, you know, of course the enemy knows your algorithm. On the other hand, picking a random secret key is very easy. One person can do it, or even a computer can do it, right? For designing an algorithm, necessarily some humans have to be involved. So that's the reason we never want to rely on an algorithm being secret. Okay, so let me come back to any other questions, and feel free to keep asking questions. I hope we can keep the class interactive. So this is as far as Caesar's cipher go, let's go back to what can be seen as a generalization of Caesar's cipher, which is known as the substitution cipher. And by the way, in the morning, we already uploaded lecture notes for the first four lectures, and you can find all this content in the lecture notes as well. So in substitution cipher, the security parameter is kind of ignored. It's an old cipher, and the key is has a fixed length. So a substitution cipher is a random permutation of the 26 English letters. Random permutation of 26 letters in the language. And what do I mean by a random permutation? Let's say you start by writing the whole list of letters, and then corresponding to A, I pick a letter at random. Let's say I want to map to C. So there are 26 possibilities for mapping A. Then a permutation means that you cannot repeat the same thing. So when I'm mapping B, I cannot pick C again, but I can pick any other letter. So let's map this to L, C is mapped to K, and so on. Okay, and this can be seen as the permutation. Encryption takes the key, which is this whole table. So this tells you that the key may not always be just a uniform random number. The key might be more intelligently sampled. So the encryption is very simple, what you would expect. Look up the table and replace each letter by the letter which it is mapped to. How does the decryption work? It's just reverse lookup in the table. If you have the table, then you can look at the character in the ciphertext, you can go back. Okay, now the question is this secure? So first of all, is the description of the cipher clear, or should we take an example of how it works?
Clear enough.
Say it's clear.
Okay. Okay, so is this cipher secure? So maybe just like Caesar cipher, let's try every possible key, right? So what is the number of possibilities for K? So can somebody tell me what is the total number of possibilities? Yeah. So this is 26 factorial. This is because when we are looking at A, we have 26 possibilities to map it to. Then since we don't want to repeat, the next letter has 25 possibilities, then 24 and so on, okay? So maybe a modern computer can go through all the possibilities, but certainly, for example, 50 years ago or 100 years ago, this was too much. Okay, so let me say this might be too much to try. Okay, so perhaps the same kind of attack as on the Caesar cipher, maybe that's not practical here for substitution ciphers. So is this secure? Any more ideas how we can try to break it?
We can just go back to Ishida's answer from earlier, frequency analysis.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so frequency analysis is a very helpful and general tool. And a lot of the classical ciphers fall to this the same technique, frequency analysis. If you have some plain text, you can also get some of the mappings pretty easily. Yeah, so there are some good suggestions. So first, even before going to the frequency analysis, let's say I get a bunch of plain text and ciphertext, right? Then I can just see what the whole mapping is, right? And how can I get a bunch of plain text and ciphertext? Again, let's go back to the war scenario, which is very helpful in illustrating many of these things. So let's say I'm the enemy and every day I intercept some ciphertext from the party which I'm fighting. And I know that the ciphertext either says attack or defend, right? Then I intercept the ciphertext and later on I can see that day what happened. Did I get attacked or were they defending? And in that case, at the end of the day, I know exactly what the message was, right? Even though it's too late, but eventually I get to know what the message was. And you know, such kind of scenarios can happen essentially in any application. At a much later point of time, maybe the message also gets leaked. And if you have the message and the ciphertext pair, you can basically reconstruct the entire table. But frequency analysis is attack. So the idea in frequency analysis is that in English language and essentially in any other language which you can consider, the letters are not randomly generated. There's a specific pattern, right? So we can consider the frequency of letters . So the frequency of E is something like 12.5%. So E happens to be the most frequent letter in English language. The frequency of T, which is the second most common letter, is 9.28%. And again, these frequencies probably also depends on the text and so on, but if you analyze large enough texts, then like these are roughly the numbers which you will see. A being the third most common, which is 8.04%. Okay, so what is the idea here? I look at the ciphertext and say, in ciphertext, and by the way, for launching this attack, I have to collect a large amount of ciphertext. Maybe I don't know the corresponding message, but so suppose in ciphertext, I notice that K is the most frequent letter. Okay, then in some sense, I have a good idea that maybe actually E was mapped to K, right? And again, let's say I can look at the second most frequent letter in the ciphertext, and that probably tells me that it's T. And I can keep going on like this, right? So so this gives us a way to decode some part of the table. Maybe it will not take you all the way. But there are other things which you can do. So there's also frequency of bigrams.
Sir, I have a small question.
Yeah.
So like the war scenario that you mentioned, that like I can guess a key and I will be able to decode, and like in the night I will find out whether I got attacked or defended, right? So, right. But my question is that, like, okay, so every morning you get the message, you try your random key generator and you try to decode it, right? But like you'll only find out in the night what happened. So every day they'll generate a new random key. So how is this process useful to us? Like, unless we know the exact message, like we can keep on trying to decode the random permutation, but like, what will be
right? So good question. If your enemy is changing the key every day, then what I described doesn't work. And
Can you repeat? I could not hear.
Yeah, I'm just saying that if your opponent is generating a new random key every day and the opponent is changing the key every day, then it doesn't work, what I described. Right. In my description, I was assuming that the key is sort of static and will be used across a long period of time.
Okay, basically, like what I'm trying to asking is that, like, even if you decode a message without the actual message, you can never find out, right, that I decoded correctly.
Well, that may or may not be true, right? Because if, let's say, you have many possible decodings and only one of them makes any sense.
Okay.
Then you know which one is the correct one.
I see.
Right? Because the plain text message is not necessarily like junk or random all the time. Presumably, the plain text message makes sense to somebody.
Okay. Thank you, sir.
Okay, so frequency of bigrams. So bigrams is a pattern of two letters which occur together pretty often. So TH is a very common combination. So this is like 3.56%. So now suppose you were able to decode T. You know what T was mapped to. And now in the ciphertext, you look at that character and you see what is the most frequent character which occurs immediately after that one. And then you have a good idea that probably it's mapped to H, right? So we have the frequency of TH, we have the frequency of IN, which is 2.43%, and so on. And then we can talk about frequency of double letters. And this is again, double E turns out to be very common. So 0.38%. Double O turns out to be very common. This is 0.21, right? So for example, in the ciphertext, let's say you see double K a lot of the times, you probably know that E was mapped to K, okay? So this is not foolproof by any means. This attack makes several assumptions. The first one is that you have a large amount of ciphertext which you were able to collect somehow. And the second is there's also a lot of hit and trial involved. So a lot of hit and trial, right? So maybe substitution cipher does have some security. Maybe, you know, it might be hard to decode it to the last letter. But the point is that once you decode enough, right, you can fill in the rest. And just getting started and making sort of the first stab is always the most difficult thing. Do any of the classical ciphers try to avoid leaking information in the length of the message? I don't know if I understand the question. That would be equivalent to just a substitution cipher. Yeah, do people ever mix Caesar cipher with substitution cipher? Exactly, that will just be equivalent to substitution cipher. You know, you combine the two and you would just end up getting a different random permutation. Okay, so substitution cipher is also not good. Maybe it's marginally better than Caesar cipher, but it's also not something which you want to try to use in practice. Okay, so now let's move on. The last classical cipher which we will look at today is something which is known as Wigner-Ray cipher. So in Wigner-Ray cipher, the key generation actually does take a security parameter as input. So key generation takes kappa as input and outputs a random English string of length, which is determined by kappa. Let's say for simplicity, just the length is kappa itself. How does the encryption work? Encryption takes this key and the message as input, and the first step is that you repeat the key. So let's, I think it's maybe easier to explain it with an example. So say the key is BAE. Okay, so in encryption first, let's say your message was, attack, and your key is BAE. Okay, so key is smaller than the message. What we do is we just repeat the key to make it equal to the message. BAE. Okay, and if, for example, your message was 5 characters instead of 6, then we will just cut off at BA. And your ciphertext is just each character of the message shifted by some number, which is determined by the corresponding character of the key. Okay. So here B corresponds to shift of 1. A corresponds to shift of 0. B corresponds to shift of 1. So the ciphertext becomes B. And T remains T because it's shifted by 0. Then T shifted by 4. Let me not spend too much time in the calculations. Okay, is the encryption clear? And then decryption is what you would expect. You just shift back, again, depending upon each character of the key. So now let's try to discuss an attack, which I guess the black marker is better than the red one, right? Right, so any ideas on how we can attack it? So let me go through the questions. If it could be one of two different words with different.
If you just length. Cased on the length of your string, couldn't you do a similar frequency analysis on each, whatever Ali is saying? Yeah.
Maybe, but sometimes the length is equal. So for example, looking at attack and defend, they have equal length. But you're right that
yeah, so
if you know, the length tells you something, then maybe.
No, on the length of like BAE.
Oh, I see. Okay.
Because one in every three letters here goes by the same shift and so on.
So current ciphers tend to be not great at leaking message length. Right. So, okay. Can you hide the message length? Maybe that's what you guys were asking all along. The short answer is unfortunately no, right? Because if I'm encrypting a 1 gigabyte file, right, I cannot hope to get a ciphertext which is like 1 megabyte. You cannot compress the message so much. So you can increase the length, but unfortunately, one problem is if you increase the length, the ciphertext is, let's say, much longer than the plain text, then this is also a reason for why your cipher might be considered inefficient, right? So in general, the length of the message is not something which we try to hide. Frequency analysis modulo length. Yeah, I think many people have the right direction. So in the attack, the first step is guess the length of the key. Maybe you are wrong. If you are wrong, all bets are off, but then you can just try again. So you might need to try several times. But length of the key is something which potentially is guessable, right? Because it's not like I'm using a key which is which can be anywhere from 1 bit to 2 to the power 100 bits, right? That's 2 to the power 100 bits is just too much. So maybe it's like 100 bits, maybe it's like 50 bits. It's not something which you cannot enumerate over. So now we will assume that our guess is correct, right? And I will tell you in that case, what happens. So now you separate out the ciphertext in many parts. Okay, so say your guess is, say the length of the key is 3 and you managed to guess that correctly, and say your ciphertext is BT. I think, let me check, one of the students thankfully did this. Oh no. Yeah, I think you used A as 1 rather than 0. Okay, let me just write something random here. BTE PXY. Now what you do is you create 3 parts because the length of the key is 3. So C is the first and the fourth character. So BP. C2 is TX. C3 is EY. Okay, now the observation is that if you look at C1, every character shifted by the same amount, right? This is because in C1, every character in some sense was encrypted with the same letter of the key. And now we are back to Caesar's cipher, right? So C1 is an instance of something which is encrypted with Caesar's cipher. C2 is again encrypted with a different key, but the same Caesar's cipher and so on. But now the problem is in Caesar's cipher, we just sort of did and we could tell when the result was correct and when it was not correct, right? Here, that may not necessarily be the case. So the next step is to do a frequency analysis. And you do this frequency analysis separately for each part or each component of the ciphertext CI. And in fact, the frequency analysis here will be much simpler than the frequency analysis in the substitution cipher, because in the substitution cipher, you had this whole random permutation, the whole table, and here it's just a single shift of all the characters. Okay. Good questions. So first, is the attack clear? And this brings me to my next point. What if the key length is actually equal to the message length? So in that case, frequency analysis just doesn't work, because you know each ciphertext component is exactly one character, and you know, I don't know what kind of frequency analysis you can do if you only have one sample. And the answer in that case is that visionary cipher is actually secure, as somebody already pointed out. And this is equivalent to one-time pad, which we will study next. And in fact, this goes for a lot of classical ciphers. So for example, in Caesar cipher, let's say you only encrypt one character. Your message is not longer than that. Then, you know, Caesar cipher is also secure, if you just use the key only once. In substitution cipher, again, let's say you're, maybe it's a little bit harder in substitution cipher. Yeah, okay. I'm not claiming anything about substitution cipher, but at least Caesar and visionary cipher are secure, assuming that the message length is short enough. So now for a change, let's try to look at some of the secure ciphers, most notably one-time pad, which is known as a very simple, perfectly secure cipher. Okay? Any questions before we move on from the subject of classical ciphers? And by the way, this is not by any means an exhaustive list of classical ciphers. There are much more, even like very sophisticated classical ciphers, like you might have heard of Enigma machine in the Second World War, which was used by Germany. And that's like a huge, interesting machine, pretty complex cipher. So let me look at the questions. By the way, feel free to just speak up. Just unmute yourself. Or chat is also fine. So one of the questions is that what is C1, C2, and C3 stand for? So if your guess for the length is, let's say, 3, right? Then you take the whole ciphertext and then you divide it into 3 parts. The first part will consist of the first letter, the fourth letter, the seventh letter, the 11th letter, or maybe the 10th letter, and so on, right? The second part, which is C2, will consist of the second letter, the fifth one, and so on. And why are we dividing ciphertext into components like this? Because all the characters in one component, they are shifted by the same amount, which might make our life simpler. (Clears throat) Yeah, so coming back to Enigma Machine, there's a very interesting movie, The Imitation Game. I don't know how many of you have seen it, but if you are interested in like classical ciphers and how it was used in the warfare earlier, it might be an interesting, fun movie to watch. The movie is about the life of Alan Turing, who is, of course, one of the founders of computer science. And he was a mathematician by training, and he was recruited by British military, I guess, to help with breaking ciphers. And one of his contributions was trying to automate this this process of breaking ciphers. So in the Second World War, Germany was sort of changing the key every day. The cipher was pretty complex. So there was this whole team of mathematicians, and they were kind of racing against time to try to find the key. And by the time they were successful, very often the key would already be changed, right? So Turing realized that there had to be a better way. And what he did was he designed this huge machine, and humans could maybe try like several keys, possibly every hour or something like that. But this machine could try various possible keys like every minute, right? And that made the process so much faster. And that helped the British actually break this this encryption scheme which the Germans were using. And the movie estimates that just this fact alone actually shortened the time of the war by something like 18 months. And it saved something like 9 or 10 million lives. And some people argue that this machine built by Turing can actually be seen as like the first modern computer. So the birth of computer science, at least in some sense, owes a little bit at least to cryptography. And in the movie, they even show this this huge machine. It's like bigger than a room and things like that. But anyway, yeah. So as I mentioned, Enigma machine is also not secure. So why is it the case that there are all these classical ciphers, you know, very smart people tried for like thousands of years, and yet all of them are insecure? So these classical ciphers and the designers, they were sort of missing one very important insight, which is something which you'll see by the end of this class, which is known as the Shannon's theorem. So we will see one-time pad and we will see Shannon's theorem. And Shannon's theorem really tells you that, you know, you completely have to change your approach to designing classical ciphers. These you know, substitutions, shifting, no combination of these things is going to help you. So now let's come back to the definition of encryption again. And let me erase some of this. Let's come back to security. If we want to design like really secure ciphers, we need to talk about what we mean by a secure cipher, right? So here I can talk about various options for security. So intuitively, a perfectly secure encryption scheme must perfectly hide the message, whatever it means, right? So here is our first attempt. Maybe probability of adversary who is given the ciphertext as input, guessing the message or outputting the message. Maybe we want this probability to be really like zero, right? And maybe that will be perfect security. So is this a good definition? Is this something we can strive towards in the ideal world? Any thoughts? Yeah, so this definition is clearly impossible. This is because you can just guess. Adversary doesn't even need to look at the ciphertext, right? So your encryption scheme can be a complete magic, but still the adversary has non-zero probability of guessing the message. Even if your message is like 1 gigabyte, right? The probability, I just make up a random string, the probability that it would be exactly equal to your message is non-zero, right? So this is not good. So maybe we were being too ambitious, right? So maybe our second attempt should be that the probability that adversary guesses the message, maybe it's not zero, but maybe it's something which is like something like really small, maybe coming from our security parameter. So say something like 2 to the power minus 100. Any thoughts on this? Good, bad? And by the way, this whole exercise tells you why it was so difficult to design encryption schemes. Because even just talking about intuitively, we understand, right, what an encryption scheme is supposed to do. But mathematically defining what an encryption scheme is supposed to do and trying to argue that the scheme you design indeed has this property, you know, that's probably very hard. Okay, so there are some good comments. The probability should be proportional to the message length. So here again, this is a good point. So again, going back to the war scenario, let's say the enemy knows that I only have two possible commands, attack or defend. Then even without looking at the ciphertext, the enemy can always guess my message with probability half. Right? So this is also too ambitious. It's not something which we can achieve. Right? So in some sense, this suggests that I need to look at the message space. I need to understand what is the a priori probability of adversary guessing the message, right? And after seeing the ciphertext, the probability cannot go down, right? Maybe it stays the same and maybe it goes up, right? Okay, so in the ideal world, the probability should stay the same. That's what I want. So very roughly, probability of guessing stays roughly the same. I don't want to specify the message space. I don't want to know which distribution you are picking your message from, what are the possible messages, and so on. What I want is that whatever the probability of guessing the message was before seeing the ciphertext, it should stay the same after seeing the ciphertext, right? So this is what I would refer to as perfect security, or you can call it perfect secrecy. Okay, do I have enough space? I think so. So perfect security. Perfect security essentially says that ciphertext is independent of the message. Now, this might seem counterintuitive, right? How can ciphertext be independent of the message? I mean, aren't we exactly encrypting the message? So let me say something here. Ciphertext distribution is independent of the message. So essentially what this says is that ciphertext doesn't tell you anything extra about M. Unless, of course, you have the key. And in that case, you can just run the decryption algorithm and you can recover the ciphertext. Sorry, the message. Okay, and a more formal definition is for every pair of messages, M1, M2, and implicitly the message has to be within the message space specified by the encryption scheme, but let me not write that explicitly here. And this is an important equation. For every pair of messages, for every ciphertext as well, in fact, the probability that encryption of K, M1 gives this ciphertext conditioned on K coming from key generation kappa is exactly equal to probability the same thing here except M1 changes to M2. Maybe I should just write it out. Conditioned on K coming from okay, I hope it's not too hard to read. So what does this equation tell me? This equation tells me that regardless of which message you started with, as long as you generated your key correctly at random, the probability that you would end up with a ciphertext C stays the same, okay? So essentially, regardless of which message you started with, ciphertext distribution is the same or identical. Any questions? And we will see an example of one-time pair. Does it independent mean that if you encrypt one message twice, you will get two different ciphertexts? No, not necessarily. And now let's look at one-time pad, which will hopefully make this a little more clear. And I want to keep the definition on screen. So, okay, so let's start from here. One-time pad has a very simple encryption scheme and yet provides you perfect security under certain conditions. So in one-time pad, the key generation takes security parameter is not really that important. One-time pad ignores the security parameter, but that's for a different reason. One-time pad is perfectly secure. So the security parameter can be thought of as infinite in one-time pad. So sample, and let me now switch back to modern times where we work with binary rather than English alphabets. But you can change that if you want. Sample a binary string k such that the length of k would be equal to the length of the message. So suppose you anticipate encrypting 100-bit messages, then you must select a key which is also 100 bits. How do you encrypt? The ciphertext is just K bitwise XOR M. Okay, I hope everybody is familiar with the XOR gate. And how do you decrypt? Output C XOR M. It's really simple and extremely fast. In hardware, for example, like you can XOR gigabytes of data per second. Why is this correct? Or why does this satisfy the correctness property? So observe that M XOR K, sorry, this should be C XOR K, not M. XOR has the cancellation property. So if you XOR with the same string twice, it just cancels out and you get back the original string. Now, what about perfect security? So let's try to compute it. For every C, such that size of the C is equal to the size of the message, which is also equal to the size of the key. What is the probability that you end up with this particular C? Probability that the encryption algorithm outputs, and by the way, for every M1 and M2. K comma M1 gives this C such that K is the output of key generation. Can somebody tell me what this probability is? And by the way, let's also call this N. Yeah. So this is just 1/(2^-n), because this is also equal to the probability that the key will end up becoming ciphertext XOR M1, such that key is sampled by the key generation, right? But given that key is random, the probability that key is equal to any specific string is actually equal to 1/(2^-n). And the same thing when I'm talking about M2. Okay. So I might be encrypting M1, I might be encrypting M2. I always get the same, exact same ciphertext distribution. The ciphertext is, note that ciphertext is entirely uniform here. And by the way, as the name suggests, we are only talking about encrypting a single message here. We will come to encrypting multiple messages with one-time pair later. Oh yeah, good. Thank you. It should be 1/2 to the power n. So now there are various natural questions which you can ask while talking about one-time pair. So the question is, what about longer message? Or what about reusing key? So that's a very natural question, right? Because in symmetric key encryption, imagine how it will be used. So let's say we have Alice and Bob, maybe they will meet in a cafe. And they will exchange some secret random number, which nobody else knows about. And then, you know, they go back to different countries. Then they are trying to encrypt messages to each other. So in that case, it's not convenient for them to like meet every day, exchange new keys and so on. So ideally, I would like to reuse my key multiple times. And ideally, maybe I want to encrypt like a 1 gigabyte file. Keep encrypting multiple long files. Yeah, there's a question, what do you mean by ciphertext is uniform? It comes from uniform distribution, which means that the probability that you see any specific string is just 1/2 to the power n. So unfortunately, one-time pair doesn't work in that case. And why is that? Let me even tell you an explicit attack on one-time pair. So given, let's say M1 XOR K and M2 XOR K, easy to compute, M1 XOR M2. So let's say this is ciphertext one, this is second ciphertext. If I just XOR these two ciphertexts together, the key just cancels out and I can recover M1 XOR M2, which might be very valuable information, right? So in particular, let's say I know one of these messages, I can immediately recover the other message. I can also immediately recover the key. Even if I don't know any of these messages, being able to compute any function of these two messages might be not what we want. Okay, so now the question is, maybe there exists a different scheme similar to one-time pair, which gives us the ability to encrypt longer messages, the ability to reuse the key and so on. So unfortunately, Shannon showed that this is not going to be possible. So Shannon's theorem. And this holds not only for one-time pair, but for any cipher which you can ever design. For a perfectly secure cipher, or let me call it perfectly secure, secret key encryption. And here the key space is K and so let's say with message space M and key space, let's say K. It must be the case that the key space is greater than or equal to the message space. Otherwise, the cipher cannot be perfectly secure. And note that this is not the length of the key or length of the message. This is the total number of possible keys. So the proof is actually pretty simple. So we will prove it by contradiction. Say there exists some secret key encryption scheme such that the key space is actually smaller than the message space. We will try to show that such a scheme cannot be perfectly secure, right? So let me just give you the intuition. So you are given, say, a ciphertext C. What you can do is you can decrypt with every possible key. Okay? Now you will end up getting messages. So you will recover some set S, which let's say is equal to S1 up to some, it's up to something, right? So these are the number of messages which you recover. And now my claim is that the size of this set S is at most equal to the size of the key space, right? Because I pick a key, I decrypt, and I will get one of these messages. So why am I not using equality here? Why am I using this less than equal to sign? And this is just because two different keys might give me the same decrypted message. Yeah, exactly. Okay, and what this means is that there exists some message M prime, which must be, So by the way, this also means that size of this set is actually less than the whole message space. This means that there should exist some message, let me call it M prime, which is a part of the message space, but M prime is not a part of this set S. Okay? This means that C could not have, and this is just a sketch, you can see a more formal proof in the notes. C could not have come from the message M prime, right? Because you decrypt C exhaustively with every possible key, you never got M prime, right? So M prime can never lead to C. This follows from the correctness property. Right, and now we are done, essentially. This means that some message M gives C with non-zero probability. Another message M prime gives C with zero probability, and this essentially directly violates the definition of perfect security. Definition of perfect security says that regardless of what message you started with, the distribution of the ciphertext must remain the same, which in particular means that the probability of every C coming from M or M prime must remain the same. And here these two probabilities are different. Okay, so this is bad news. Does this mean that we have to live in a world where keys cannot be reused or you know, you cannot really encrypt long files and so on. So maybe that's what it looked like when Shannon's theorem came out. And Shannon's theorem is really the reason why things like frequency analysis and so on, they work, and they break all the classical ciphers. But the good news is that this attack requires decrypting the ciphertext with every possible key. And by the way, this Shannon's theorem does give you an explicit attack, right? Because given a ciphertext C, maybe I don't know the message which it is encrypting, but I know the message which it is not encrypting. In particular, it's not encrypting M prime, which is still bad, right? Right, so Shannon's theorem, in order to launch this attack, requires decrypting the ciphertext with every possible key. And if the number of possible keys is like 2 to the power 100, then certainly modern computers cannot launch this attack. Even it might be hard even for supercomputers to launch this attack. So this is our hope, and this is what we will try to exploit in the next few lectures to get sort of good encryption schemes, which hopefully can be used in practice. And a possible exercise for you to play with is you can try to design a perfectly secure encryption scheme where the key size is smaller than the message size.